Hi, Wee Bob here, and the question that has been on my mind this week quite a lot was about ideas. How do I find ideas, not just for drawing, but YouTube videos, and that includes this video. So how do you even start your journey in getting your ideas onto the canvas, turning them into a reality? So this video hopefully will help you, as well as there are a few tips and tricks as we travel along our little story here. So you sit down at your digital desk and stare at the screen. Then you do one of those cursed acts which deletes time faster than any job I have ever had, and that is looking at other artists' work. Pinterest, Instagram, and TikTok. You've spent 4 hours looking at references, you've got 1 hour left to draw, enough time to draw a wee stick man. So I guess tip one would be use references, but set yourself a time limit for looking, and perhaps look at them on your lunch break instead of watching those 500 TikToks you just scrolled through. After we have found our references, we can stare at those beautiful pictures, those beautiful images, paintings, and stare at our blank piece of canvas and sit there wondering, what art story do I tell? Or simply, what will this idea be? And we pull our hair out trying to get started. And I was struggling this week as to what video idea would help you guys the most and be of worthwhile to you. So we all struggle with ideas and arranging our thoughts, but tip two is the technique that has helped me quite a lot. Don't overthink it. If you've got a method, like mine's is usually around drawing a shape and then just putting down some base colours and taking it from there. Get the idea out there and see where it takes you. Anyway, I have been working on this drawing for a few days, spending about 2.5 hours after work. That's about, I maybe get an hour each night to draw after work and dinner and all the other things that life has in store. But overall, this piece took about 3 hours. So you have done all the previous things and you have something on the canvas that emerges from your mind. Perhaps it is a study of a particular reference, or in my case, I am trying to find what it is that I like to draw. I like to paint portraits. So I know I like to paint portraits. I like landscapes as well. I like computer magazines, game covers. And so combining them and adding in some weirdness seems to be what kind of escapes from my brain. I found doing this drawing easy and relaxing, unlike my The Last of Us drawing, which I showed you in my last video, which I was really pleased with, and I know that I can get to that result. But I found doing this drawing so much easier, and I think it's because when I draw particular people that are famous or someone you know, the idea of getting their faces looking correct almost puts a big blocker up on the ability to draw and to let the ideas flow from your brain. And that might just be me. You may have a similar problem where you're just like, that doesn't look like the person, so you can't show anybody it because they're going to laugh at you. That's what you feel like. But once I've got my idea down on the canvas, Joel, Ellie, The Last of Us, some of those other bits that I added in, the giraffe in the middle, the butterfly, that was a wee bit easier for me to do because I wasn't trying to get so much of a particular look to it, and it was a wee bit more freehand. So you've got to kind of think, what is it your brain works with? So you might wonder, where can you get ideas from? And everyone has their own way of painting, or what they love. A lot of my art friends love realism. I like looking at it, but personally I don't find realistic drawing fun to do. I was watching Temi Danzo, she's an artist on YouTube, but she talked about a condition called aphantasia, I think that's how you say it, apologies if I got that wrong, which I had never heard of, but it basically is an inability to visualise or image-free thinking. My mind's eye sees things, and when I see shapes in a canvas, my brain fills in those details. She's basically saying she needs a reference and she needs to copy that reference because her mind cannot visualise what it should look like, and she paints it and her paintings are beautiful. So it's clear that we're all different and we've all got different takes on life, and I have spoke about this in my previous videos. But as I sat struggling this week as to what to talk about, I thought I would just do some random painting on this face in the sky piece that I've been drawing. So just grabbing various brushes and see what happens. It turned out that my way of working ended up bringing out tips and tricks that you can perhaps use in your drawings to just see where your thought process takes you. So the third tip, trick, that I have is to think back to those shapes you drew as a kid, the squares, the circles, and just start drawing them. I started just lightening this part of the drawing with rectangle type shapes, and then I thought it would be a good idea to go and get the perspective tool. And the perspective tool can be found under the edit menu or shift P on the keyboard. I just randomly chose the area where the vanishing point would go and made these five bar type shapes. Some of the thoughts that I had when painting this, perhaps this is a Hogwarts train returning after the Christmas break to the school, and we've got some Dementors or Death Eaters coming down next to the train. And so I kind of played on that a wee bit with some particle effects. But so the story of the train, it could be going to Hogwarts. And I was also thinking in my head over the past few days that when we return, or when we look at Harry Potter, when we look at stories, we sometimes have this inability to see the bad parts of that life. You think, oh, I'm going to Hogwarts, I've got my letter to go become a wizard, all is happy in the world. And it's not, because everybody on that individual train, although they're fictional people, if they were real people, they would have their own problems, their own worries and their own anxieties that they have to deal with, the blocks that come up in front of them and the things that they've got to overcome. And I think it's one of the good things about painting, it's one of the good things about stories, is that we can lose ourselves and the escapism and just forget about the problems for a wee while. But another tip that came out of this experiment that I was doing was learning to paint different surfaces as a subject all on its own. But tip four is that, as you can see here, highlights can give us this metal shiny effect, or maybe it's a waveform heading to our new vanishing point, which I decided it was going to be different. So trying out the new grunge brushes to give this effect, and then the sky cracking, but I have no real idea why I did it that way. It just comes out of my brain and onto the canvas. Perhaps it's from memory of something I've seen in the past. Following using these last two tips, I would then say tip five is that we get a nice water reflection using a dabbing technique. So after using the dabbing effect, we can maybe call tip six the fact that we can have multiple images on the one canvas. It doesn't need to be one person, it can be multiple. And what is the subject that we're trying to compose? What's the story we're trying to tell? And just chuck things down there and see what happens in your brain. And if your brain doesn't work that way, stick four or five of your references together and draw an element of each of them. The Last of Us painting was more or less like that. It was, I like these images, I'm going to draw them. So tip seven is that even when we're writing and making mistakes and erasing things, maybe on a different layer, we can push the paint around, bring effects to the image, to the drawing, to the painting that we may not purposefully have set out to achieve. My brain sees things as I push paint around, I see shapes form. So it's a good idea just to let your thoughts and mind get onto the paper in whatever method you use. Tip eight would be that when we stick to a set colour palette, our drawings, paintings will look that wee bit more professional. They will look professional because colour matters a lot. And overall, I wanted to get a warm tone with this painting, so I chose a restricted colour palette. But the story here, the story that I'm trying to tell, the beginning being how do you come up with an idea, to the journey being just get those ideas down onto the paper, just start, put the pen to the paper, scribble, do some crazy thing with layers, try everything. My mum this week was asking me to help her with a crafting program that she uses. And I said to her, I said, Mum, the way I learn programs is that I go in and I press every button that I can find. And I just literally go through every button to see what it does. And if it doesn't appear to do anything, I maybe go and look at the help menu or look online for an answer. But the idea is that if you look at the likes of Rebelle, if you look at any software, it can be quite overwhelming to start with, to just look at that and see all these buttons that appear in front of you. And you've kind of just got to laser focus down onto one thing at a time and don't overwhelm yourself. This process of experimenting, I sort of just lost myself in the painting process, and I absolutely love when that happens. I feel transported to another world, and things I might be worried about when I'm painting, those things melt away. So tip 9 is to try and find those activities that'll take you to that other realm, or to the flow, where you can just enjoy the process of drawing, storytelling. Don't try to force yourself into a box that you think you should be in. That artist draws like this, so I should be able to draw like that. That doesn't mean you shouldn't be determined or have a determined attitude. A lot of this YouTube stuff is not the flow. It's looking up art books online, reading art books, trying to figure out what lessons I could perhaps help people with, which I enjoy doing, but it does quite often take determination. It takes that first step to putting your paintbrush on the canvas and seeing what comes to life. On that note, I want to wish everybody the best for 2023. Thank you so much for the support you guys give me, for watching, liking, subscribing, all that good stuff. And Wee Bob is out.